Hachette Audio presents Can I Have My Ball Back? Written and read by Richard Herring. There are also some lovely extras coming at the end of the book, so do stay tuned. There's a few interviews with various characters from the story and a special extra little podcast, so that's exciting, isn't it? Listen to the book first, though, because they won't make sense. There's some spoilers, I guess. No one goes right to the end and listens to the extras first, do they? Come on. For Dick, Matt, Tony and Thalia. Prologue. In 2002, I was on the worst holiday of my life. I was in Barbados with my girlfriend of a few months, staying in an exclusive boutique hotel right on the beach. I admit that so far, this doesn't sound like the worst holiday of my life, but bear with me. This always rather dramatic relationship was about to explode. Unbeknownst to me, my girlfriend had spent the night before we left with her ex, who'd taken the opportunity to propose to her. She had decided to come on holiday with me anyway, but was mulling over the offer and secretly ringing her ex-slash-potential-husband from the telephone in our room when I was sunbathing. The worst part of that is I was paying for everything, including these international calls from a hotel room. I was getting billed for this cuckolding. Things were a bit weird and tense, though I, of course, didn't know why. On the second or third day, I went for a paddle in the sea. I don't like taking risks, and I'm not into surfing or paragliding or scuba diving or even just swimming in the ocean, really. I was literally just trying to cool off in the shallow water. I was maybe 5 metres from the shore, the water not even up to my swimming trunks, when the swelling sea decided to swell a bit more, and I was sucker punched by a wave that sent me somersaulting off my feet, turning me 180 degrees and causing my head to smash down on the stony sand beneath. I was winded and confused, and fierce waves were now crashing around me and threatening to pull me out into the depths. I somehow scrambled the tiny distance to the safety of the shore and lay on the beach, breathing heavily, considering how close I had come to death. Not very. And how pathetic a death that would have been. Very. My head and shoulder had taken the brunt of the impact, but I felt like I'd been through the spin cycle of a washing machine and my stomach was sore. More worryingly, over the next few hours, my right testicle swelled up to about 3 times its regular, not inconsiderable, size. It probably goes without saying, at least to 50% of the readership, that this was extremely uncomfortable. It was also bamboozling. How could a bang on the head have such an impact on my gonad? My girlfriend didn't seem too concerned that fun, sexy times were now off the menu. If anything, there was a palpable sense of relief on her part. While I recuperated, she headed off to experience the local nightlife on her own. Maybe she was out cheating on me and her potential fiancé, although it doesn't really matter. None of the central players in this story were ready for a committed relationship. I struggled through the rest of the week. Sometimes I left the room, unknowingly giving her the opportunity to carry on her transatlantic conversation, but whatever I did, the discomfort was constant. That was nothing, though, compared with what I would go through on the plane ride home. My swollen testicle, still continuously throbbing with pain, was able to gauge changes in atmospheric pressure. As the craft went higher, the agony became even more excruciating. Every metre we climbed was a kick in the ball. Perhaps airlines could get rid of expensive altimeters and instead employ big bollocked men to let the pilot know their exact height based on the intensity of their screams. Looking back, I've wondered why God was punishing me when I was the one who'd been wronged. Now, admittedly, I'd also cheated on my girlfriend a couple of times in the relationship, but that is hardly the point. We broke up in the cab home from the airport. That's my girlfriend and me, not me and my testicle, though I'd happily have jettisoned it over the ocean. I only found out about the proposal a couple of weeks later from a friend of her friend. My girlfriend denied it, but I rang the number that kept appearing on my itemised hotel bill, and guess who answered? In case you're wondering, their engagement didn't work out, and a couple of months later, my ex and I briefly hooked up again, because we were both idiots who thrived on the excitement and the wrongness of it all. I also went to the doctor about my inflated love egg. He thought that I'd probably ripped my stomach lining in the tumultuous sea. As there are nerves that connect your stomach to your acorn hammock, he said this trauma was the cause of my testicular mishap. I don't really remember what happened next. He must have given me some pills. My genitals certainly returned to their regular, breathtaking size, and I got on with my life. My broken heart healed as quickly as my pumped-up beach ball, and I moved on. This became an amusing anecdote of doomed love and damaged ghoulies, but fate, that ultimate court jester of the human condition, was already percolating a punchline that would be 20 years in the making. Comedy is tragedy plus time, then a bigger tragedy. Chapter 1. Grow some balls. Balls. They're a symbol of strength, yet they're the weakest and most vulnerable part of the human body. They represent masculinity, and yet, with a well-placed kick or even a firm poke, the feeblest child can reduce a muscle-bound jock to a squirming heap on the floor. If we're cowardly, we're told to grow some. If we're brave, we're said to have huge ones. If it's cold, they're liable to fall off, even if you're a brass monkey. If we're in trouble, someone will threaten to break them. If we have to work hard, we might very well bust them. If we're in somebody's thrall, then they've got us by them. Balls are a euphemism for something useless and mendacious, unless they belong to a dog, in which case, for some unfathomable reason, they are the best thing ever. Now, for my money, dog's bollocks are some of the least appealing bollocks out there, and given how awful bollocks are in general, that's really saying something. They are possibly the least attractive external body part, resembling two kiwi fruits bulging in a hairy shopping bag. They're not even symmetrical, and yet, even in this age of plastic surgery, hardly anyone elects to have the things snipped off to make their undercarriage more aesthetically pleasing. They are often neglected and ignored, very much the backing singers in the band that is the male genitalia, overshadowed by the charismatic frontman. They're the equivalent of the two blokes who stand at the back in East 17 making weird shapes with their hands. I'm doing it now, I hope you are too. Even those of us who have them don't think about them too often unless they are in peril. Yet there, hanging between the legs of roughly 50% of the human beings on the planet, and let's not forget all the animals, birds and fish that have them too, are one or two, or occasionally more, of the most magical, almost fantastical, godlike Genesis machines on the planet, spewing out potential new lives at an improbable rate. A pair of functioning human testes in their prime produce 1,500 sperm every second of the day. That's something like 525 billion sperm cells churned out of those weird, gristly clumps of tubules in a human lifetime. An estimated 21.5 gallons of semen, enough to fill half a bath. That's according to Andrew Fiuzzi. How much cum do you throw away over the course of a lifetime? From www.melmagazine.com. Check it out, it's quite a fun article. If half a bath is a bit of a letdown for a lifetime of spunk production, remember that, with the help of an enthusiastic and determined friend, you could fill your tub to the brim. Although, if you're planning to have a bath in your lifetime's worth of jizz, you might want to be careful about filling the thing that high. Remember the work of Archimedes. In some ways, it's better to luxuriate in half a bath of gametes than to send a volume equivalent to your own mass spilling out on the bathroom floor. 525 billion sperm. That is a lot of potential people. Given that most men will father somewhere between 0 and 3 children in their lifetimes, there's a huge volume of sex mess going to waste. If God is serious about every sperm being sacred, every man who has ever lived is in an awful lot of trouble. Though to be fair, it's God who's made us have so much of the stuff, so this is, at the very least, entrapment. Even someone like Genghis Khan, who allegedly fathered thousands of children, and to whom we are all almost certainly related, wasted essentially the same number of Tadger tadpoles as any other man in percentage terms. If there was only one testicle in the universe producing this amount of latent life, it would be worshipped as a god, or at least appear in an episode of Star Trek shooting terrifying giant space fish at Captain Kirk, who I think might secretly like that. Yet this miraculous gobbing globule is so commonplace, it hangs between the legs of approximately 4 billion living humans, as well as having been possessed by maybe another 50 billion dead ones. Even if you're the only cojones owner in the room, you usually have two of the things. Their ubiquity makes them ordinary, and the willingness of most owners to liberally share the contents of their testes means there is never any danger of scarcity. Consequently, rather than being revered, this pair of hairy deities in our pants are regarded as comical and ridiculous, like a slightly less wrinkly version of the Chuckle Brothers. As if the production of 130 million spermatozoa isn't enough for you, these great balls of fire also produce testosterone, assisting the development of the genitals, firing up the process of puberty and prompting muscle and bone growth, as well as creating libido and the ability to maintain erections. That's some serious multitasking, which, even on a non-divine level, we should be grateful for. For me, though, the most remarkable fact about the McSquirter twins, that's a euphemism that sadly will be lost on anyone who didn't watch the British TV show Record Breakers in the 1970s, is that if they are transplanted from one person to another, they will continue to manufacture the sperm of the original owner. For this reason, testicle transplants are very rare indeed, and are only carried out in extraordinary circumstances between identical twins, to avoid the moral quandary of somebody fathering another person's child. If you get someone else's heart, you don't start to love the things they loved, except in fanciful horror films. If you're given someone else's kidney, you don't start to wee their wee. Even someone else's blood will become yours once it's in your arteries. Aside from the even more magical ovaries, which I, admittedly wrongly, like to think of as the super testicles of a superior species, there is only one other organ of the human body that, one would assume, would refuse to give up the identity of its originator if it were to be successfully transplanted. The brain. People talk about men having their brains in their pants, but in this sense, we do. We have a pair of organs so loyal that they remain ours and keep shooting out our progeny, even if they migrate to a different ball bag. Like a sort of anti-Borg, they refuse to be assimilated. It's a Star Trek reference. Just watch Star Trek. Yet most pod possessors are so blasé about our human glue factories that we can't really be bothered to just check them over once a month to ensure there are no lumps or bumps. I get it. About 15 years ago, I took part in a campaign to encourage men to have a little non-sexual feel every now and again, and even I didn't really bother to check my own. It was embarrassing and weird, and if there was something wrong, I didn't want to know about it. If I didn't know about it, then it couldn't hurt me. Anyway, that kind of stuff only happens to other people. On the ball. As well as sharing my own personal story, I also want to use this book to give you a flavour of balls throughout history, their function, their cultural and artistic significance, and how they have become associated with particular attributes, some real, but many imaginary. These bulbous additions will dangle between each chapter as a little amuse-bouche or palate cleanser. I hope you enjoy my gobbets. Why the low-hanging fruit? I've always felt that the placement of a man's testicles is an eloquent argument against intelligent design. That's Mark Lawrence. The big question about balls that needs answering straight away is this. Why the hell are they outside the body and not sealed deep within us, shielded by the same kind of armour that you see on rhinos, but also studded with diamonds, and including some kind of built-in missile system to repel attackers? I've always understood that it was to do with temperature. Ideal sperm production occurs at 35 degrees Celsius, but the inside of the body is 37 degrees Celsius, and so our balls have descended out of our abdomens and into this stupid, ugly, unprotected sack in an effort to stay cool, like two little funsies. Wait a minute, though. Elephants and birds have a higher body temperature than we do, but still have internal balls. Furthermore, whales, dolphins and seals don't leave their balls dangling behind them in the nice cool ocean, perhaps for fear of them acting as bait for fish or sharks. Theirs are neatly tucked inside too. Has science lied to us? The temperature theory was first proposed in 1890 by Joseph Griffiths, who tried to prove his point by pushing dogs' bollocks back into their abdomens and sewing them in place so they couldn't pop out. Luckily for him, he was a scientist, so this kind of behaviour was acceptable and not an indication he would soon be going on a terrible killing spree. After a few days, Griffiths discovered that the pushed-back sewn-up bollocks had degenerated. What a surprise! And sperm production had more or less ceased. He decided that this was due to the higher temperatures inside the body and not the stress and shock he'd caused by messing around with canine genitals. Some academics have offered other theories, with the most fanciful being a suggestion that our vulnerable plums might be somehow equivalent to peacock feathers. Peacocks are much more susceptible to prey because of their colourful tail plumage, but that disadvantage is outweighed by the fact that peahens get moist for those crazy feather displays. Thus, some scientists have genuinely argued maybe vulnerable balls are also some kind of ornamental display intended to wow the ladies. As Jesse Baring puts it, if the organism can thrive and survive while still being hobbled by a costly maladaptive trait such as elaborate cumbersome plumage or, in this case, vulnerably drooping gonads, then it must have some high-quality genes and be a valuable mate. That's Jesse Baring. How are they hanging? From psmag.com, 26th of April 2013. Another great article, check it out. Even the people who came up with this theory thought it was unlikely. Besides, if it was such an evolutionary advantage, then ball sacks would have evolved to come down to our knees and be brightly coloured and maybe placed between two massive cymbals that would pulverise them every time our legs knocked together. Also, I think it's fair to say that if this theory were true, women would be much more interested in balls than they are. There would be young men with their balls out on page 3 of tabloid newspapers. Dildos would come with huge dangling appendages, and balls would be greeted with gasps and reverence rather than mockery and scarcely hidden disgust. The position of human balls probably is to do with temperature, but maybe not for the reasons originally posited. Some have argued that cooler temperatures might stop DNA from mutating, while evolutionary psychologist G.G. Gallup proposed the activation hypothesis, which states that sperm are kept cooler than body temperature so that once the lucky ones find themselves in the warmer vaginal canal, they know they're about to get the chance to fulfill their purpose and get turned on, maybe in both senses of the word, increasing their mobility so they have a chance to get to their goal before the hot female body fries them. Or to quote the more scientific Gallup, descended scrotal testicles evolved to both capitalise on this copulation slash insemination contingent temperature enhancement and function to prevent premature activation of sperm by keeping testicular temperatures below the critical value set by body temperatures. That's from Gordon G. Gallup et al. On the origin of descended scrotal testicles, the activation hypothesis, which was in Evolutionary Psychology, October 2009. I hope you're going to read all these sources after you've read my book. I think the way I put it was better. Whatever the reason, I still have to ask, couldn't the balls be outside the body and have diamond-studded rhino armour that fires missiles at intruders? Or how about just a nice rounded cup made of bone to act as a nest for these precious eggs? Would that have been too much to ask for, evolution? You massive prick. Chapter 2. I can't imagine what that would be like. To say the least, 2020 had been a bit of a distracting year. Not only was there the lingering fear of illness and death from COVID-19 hanging over us all, but with the NHS stretched to its limits, it had struck me pretty quickly that this would also be a terrible time to get ill with something else. Imagine being unlucky enough to get cancer now, I thought, never considering the possibility that it might happen to me. I was 53 and come from hardy stock. My parents are in their mid-80s and still fit, while my grandparents had all made it to 75, with my grandma finally deciding to give the bucket a toe punt when she was 102. I'd never spent a night in hospital, except when my kids were born, but I don't think that counts. And it doesn't seem fair that my wife got a bed while I was supposed to sleep in a very uncomfortable chair. Yet when I complained, my wife seemed annoyed and even called me selfish. And there was no indication that anything was wrong with me at all. Well, not with my body. Lockdown had already brought about one surprising self-discovery. I'd chanced across a social media post that asked me to visualise an apple with my mind's eye. I closed my eyes, fully expecting to see a nice, ripe, golden delicious hovering around in my brain space, but there was nothing. However hard I tried, only empty blackness. The exercise was literally fruitless. Apparently, many people can bring to mind a 3D image of an apple in full colour. Adam Buxton boasted to me that he was a mental gymnast who could make his apple spin around, the show-off. Others see a dimmer version, maybe in 2D, maybe without colour. But I see nothing. Not a sausage. And, more pertinently, not an apple. I'd even be happy if I could see a sausage when I'm trying to see an apple, but I can't see a thing. Before seeing that social media post, I'd had no idea that I couldn't produce mental images. I'd always imagined that I could. Although when I imagined that, it turns out, I wasn't actually seeing myself imagining it, because I can't imagine. My point is that before this revelation, or perhaps non-revelation, I would confidently have told you that I could visualise, but now I realise that the way I think is much more abstract. If I'm called upon to imagine an apple or a tree or the faces of my children, I think of the word and then get a vague sense of the object or person, along with the briefest of flashes of a suggestion of an image, like a fractured reflection on water that still remains somehow behind my field of vision. If I try to think of the colour blue, I know what blue is, but I see no blue whatsoever. The only thing I can think of is the empty blackness that must come with death. It turns out that I have aphantasia. My mind's eye is blind. I still see images in my dreams, and sometimes vague and uncontrollable random ones fly into my brain as I drift off to sleep, but nothing else. It was quite demoralising to discover that I was missing out on something that others took for granted. It's not a nice feeling to be deficient, even if you didn't know that you were until that moment. I wished I'd never found out. Until I discovered that I couldn't see mental images, I'd assumed that I could, that my way was the way everyone experienced thought. Of course, by telling you this, I've just made about 1 in 100 listeners aware of their own aphantasia. I wish I could picture your horrified faces. My mind was on my mind, but my balls were not. Did I even get an inkling that something might be going on in my nutsack? Perhaps I'd noticed a slight change in the way things were hanging, but I put this down to middle age. In my most recent stand-up show, Oh Frig, I'm 50, I discussed the fact that gravity takes its effects on men's bodies in ways that aren't usually talked about. I revealed that in your 50s, there's a genuine chance you might sit on your own testicles. I pretended that I had a system where I'd get my balls swinging from side to side like pendulums, using centrifugal force, and once they touched at the zenith of their arc, I know I was safe to be seated. None of this was true. I'd never even come close to sitting on my balls when I wrote that routine, and as I entered my sixth decade in 2017, everything was hanging tight. Maybe fate wanted me to pay for my comedic mendacity, because in the autumn of 2020, life imitated art, and as I went to sit down on my bed, my nut nudged its way under my buttock and would have taken the full weight had I not leapt to my feet at first contact. It still smarted. I was surprised and upset, but it was surely karma. I joked about this, and now it had happened. So I assumed that middle age had caught up with me. Similarly, if my ball seemed heavier in the bath, it must be the same deal. Just another of the awful effects of getting older. Horrible hanging conkers dangling down around your knees. There to make it absolutely clear to you, and anyone unlucky enough to catch sight of them, that you're no longer a sexually desirable entity. In any case, I didn't have time to worry about it at this point. I was all caught up in homeschooling, wondering when I could perform live comedy again, starting up an insane live stream ventriloquism show in my attic, and unsuccessfully trying to cure my blind mind's eye. It wasn't until January 2021 that I began to idly wonder if something was wrong. The ball wasn't merely heavier, it felt like it was getting larger and maybe a bit harder than I remembered. Or was I imagining it? Was I capable of imagining anything? I certainly didn't tell anyone about it, not even Catie, my wife. There were no lumps or bumps on my magic bean, which is what I understand you were supposed to look out for. Everything seemed to be functioning as normal. The only things coming out of my balls were the things that were meant to come out, maybe in less impressive quantity than 20 years ago, but again, that's middle age. The ball did undoubtedly feel weird, though. It was a bit scary, the kind of scary where you decide not to look into it in case you find out something you don't want to. Eventually, I was concerned enough to Google my symptoms. I can't remember what I searched for or exactly what page I ended up on, but I know that I was satisfied from this search that I didn't have anything to worry about. How that is possible is a mystery to me now, because every subsequent time I've Googled the issue, all results have said something along the lines of what you'll find on the NHS website. Lumps and swellings in the testicles can have lots of different causes. Most are caused by something harmless, such as a buildup of fluid, cyst, or swollen veins in the testicles, varicocele. Sometimes they can be a sign of something serious, such as testicular cancer. Don't try to self-diagnose the cause of your lump. Always see a GP. Did I stop reading after the second sentence? Did I see what I hoped I would see? Or was I simply feeling embarrassed or frightened? Whatever was going on in my trouser brain, I did not go to see my GP. I didn't want the distraction either, because amazingly, I'd actually got some work. In lockdown. I know! I was heading to Wales to take part in a feature film. This kind of thing doesn't happen to me very often, slash ever, and I didn't want to have a doctor tell me I'd have to cancel the trip, and with it, my chance of becoming a movie star. Instead, I let my swollen ball keep on swelling, maybe hoping it would deflate on its own. Instead, something weirdly symbolic, or symbolic, was on the horizon. On the ball, the origin of the testes. Ever wondered where your favourite bits of bollocky slang might have started? Here are a few possibilities. The dog's bollocks. I have researched the subject quite thoroughly, but have been unable to find out why this term became a synonym for outstanding. The phrase, the dog's bollocks, was originally the nickname given to a typographical construction consisting of a colon followed by a hyphen, like, it looks a bit like, just look at it now, a colon and then a dash. It looks a bit like a penis with some balls. Why that was thought to resemble a dog's bollocks when it's similar to the male genitalia of many species, including humans, and clearly includes a penis, I can't tell you. Surely the colon alone should signify bollocks. The phrase was used as early as 1949 by etymologist Eric Partridge, so let's blame him. I can only assume he spent a lot of time looking at dogs' genitals, and so when he saw a colon followed by a hyphen, that's what leapt to mind. This doesn't explain why it became a synonym for excellence. Perhaps the printers who popularised the term thought that this early crack at an emoji was so brilliant that it could double up to mean something was outstanding. According to the Oxford English Dictionary, OED, the earliest recorded use of the dog's bollocks as a superlative is from the 1986 version of The Gambler, a musical by Peter Brewis, Bob Goody and Mel Smith, first staged at Hampstead Theatre, London. It includes the line, "When it comes to Italian opera, Pavarotti is the dog's bollocks." Unsurprisingly, another early adopter of the phrase was the hilarious and pioneering adult comic Viz, which always has its ear to the filthy ground, searching out poetry of the gutter. If you've never read their Rogers Profanosaurus, one of the most important literary works of our age, I strongly recommend it. Their 1989 compilation edition is called Viz, The Dog's Bollocks, the best of issues 26 to 31. That takes balls. Testicles have long been associated with courage, with Greek and Roman medical writers very literally seeing balls as the source of male bravery. Medieval writers picked up the ball, and it continues to represent valour to this day. It's impossible to identify the person who originally made this connection, but my guess is that it was a caveman with massive knackers who managed to spin his unfeasibly large testicles into something positive. To give someone a bollocking. The OED gives the earliest meaning of bollocking as to slander or defame, and suggests that it entered the English language thanks to the 1653 translation of one of Rabelais' works, which includes the Middle French expression encouilletant, translated as ballocking. The earliest printed use of it in the sense of a severe reprimand is, according to the OED, from 1946. Presumably, the verb here implies a violent act upon one's testicles, hence the negative association. Chapter 3. Bursting My Bubble. Being a movie star did not turn out to be as glamorous as I'd expected. We were filming in a rainy South Wales in January 2021, though including rainy in that sentence is practically a tautology. The United Kingdom was basically shut down, but actors were, for some reason, allowed to work, as long as we were regularly tested and stayed in our bubbles. I guess this means we were on the front line. Nothing is more important than the continuation of independent films. Why weren't people banging pots on their doorsteps for actors? Setting off from my Hertfordshire home, I found that the motorways were eerily quiet. I felt conspicuous and criminal and was concerned that I would be stopped by the police and imprisoned for contravening a lockdown. I had an official letter, an easily forgeable printout of an email, to show to the authorities in the event of my capture. This was, hopefully, the closest my generation would get to being in The Great Escape. It's quite rare that I get acting work, and I was keen to make a good impression. I also have a pathological fear of being late, so I'd set off early and arrived with over an hour to spare. I was tired from the journey. It was, after all, the first time in over a year that I'd driven this kind of distance, and I was keen to get my first all-important COVID test over with and have some dinner. The sat-nav took me to a lorry loading bay with closed barriers. I was told over an intercom that I'd come to the wrong entrance. Well, duh. The voice gave me directions, but they washed over me, and the minute I'd turned around, I was confused and lost. I pulled over to see if I could ring anyone, but every number I tried went straight to voicemail. I'd got an email saying that the COVID test was now happening at a different venue and fed the new postcode into my sat-nav. It was getting dark, and as so often happens when you only have a postcode, my electronic guidance system, which I rely on because for some reason I'm unable to picture maps in my mind, led me to a desolate location where there were no buildings at all. I drove back and forth a few times before taking a punt on a sign for a tourist attraction, making my way up a long, winding driveway. A couple of hundred metres along, there was a group of men in high-vis jackets. They seemed to know about the filming and waved me on. There was a car park round the corner and signs indicating a COVID facility, so I parked up, assuming, not unreasonably, that I'd arrived at the testing site. A scattering of people were heading towards the building, so I followed them and found myself in the large hall of a stately home. There were medical staff behind a desk, but they'd not heard about the filming. I soon established that this was a vaccination centre, not a testing one. The staff said the only place that they knew of that was doing tests was the crematorium, which seemed a bit on the nose, but I guess that way they could deal with the severe COVID cases in one visit. Why were all the details I'd been given wrong? Why couldn't I get through to anyone on the phone? Was this all an elaborate prank by Jeremy Beadle? Had he gone to the trouble of faking his own death 13 years earlier to lull me into a false sense of security? I was now officially late and getting fraught. Without thinking things through, I decided to try and find the crematorium. I got back into my car and drove past the men in high-vis jackets, not thinking to ask them for clarification, but instead hoping they didn't see me and question why I was leaving. As I got to the main road, I had to drive over one of those one-way spike devices that burst your tyres if you go over them in the wrong direction. I was going in the right direction, so it wasn't a problem. I immediately got lost again. Panicking, I disconnected the logical part of my brain and started running on adrenaline-soaked instinct. I decided that the testing centre couldn't be the crematorium or the stately home. My brain must have been screaming, "Then how come the high-vis jacket guys knew about the film?" But I wasn't listening, or maybe I just assumed that they were all Jeremy Beadle, wearing a false beard over his real beard so I wouldn't recognise him. Like a headless chicken, I took the next right and ended up in a tiny lane that tapered down to a car's width and then hit a dead end. Never a fan of reversing long distances, I had to do a 58-point turn to get my large VW Charan facing back in the right direction. I drove back up the main road, trying to find an alternative venue, almost weeping with the stress of it all. I'd burned up another half an hour and gone back and forth three or four times looking for a turning that wasn't there, going back up the long driveway and then turning around because I couldn't face talking to the high-vis men and admitting that I was lost. Manly pride meant that I would be emasculated if I asked for help. Finally, hungry, angry and bewildered, I had to admit that the high-vis men were my only hope. I went back up that driveway for the third time. Someone, maybe another lost and confused actor, had parked their car right by the gate and I had to drive around it. In my heightened emotional state, I may have been driving faster and less accurately than I should have been. Suddenly I became aware of an unpleasant thudding and flapping sound. Was my car tilting? I'd had so much bad luck already that driving the wrong way over a one-way spike device would surely be too much to add to my plate. Even I couldn't pretend that the car wasn't noticeably listing as it bumped its way along the road. I'd clipped the edge of the spiky thing on my way round the parked car. The men in the high-vis jackets were observing my progress with a mixture of concern and barely contained glee. As I wound down my window, one of them observed, "I think you might have a flat tyre there, mate." "Yeah, I know," I said, trying to make it sound as if this had been a choice rather than an error. They let me park up in an empty car park and said they'd keep an eye on the car. I told them I was lost, and they explained that I was meant to have taken a right up the hill before the vaccination centre car park, which would have brought me to the castle. It would have been nice if they'd said that the first time. Or if they had said it, it would have been nice if I'd listened properly. Either way, it was their fault. I took my suitcase and suit bag and laptop bag out of the boot and set out to walk to the castle. It couldn't be that far. It was that far. And then a bit further. Once I'd rounded a bend, I could see the dimly lit castle in the distance. The road seemed to go on forever and get steeper with each step. As I got closer, I fancied I could take a shortcut across the grass. I stepped in unseen muddy puddles and water seeped into my shoes and socks. The gates on this side of the building were all locked, so I squelched my way back to the road. I was so far beyond the end of my tether that I considered lying down and dying right there, and it didn't seem like the worst option. I summoned up some residue of inner strength and pushed onwards. Finally, I rounded a corner and saw parked cars and human beings. I was where I was meant to be and where I could have been a good 90 minutes earlier if only I'd asked for clearer instructions. All my fear of being unpunctual had been for nothing, as the production was in enough chaos of its own. We were meant to be sleeping in a nearby student outdoor adventure centre, but the central heating had broken, so the crew were desperately trying to find a local hotel that could accommodate the 30 people in the cast and crew while keeping us in our bubble. On top of this, COVID tests were taking forever. as each person had to wait for their results before the next one could be tested, which meant we were going through at a rate of one every 30 minutes. Exhausted and hungry and unpleasantly damp, I was fifth in the queue. When I finally got to the front, my first ever COVID test was a trial by fire. The man giving the test must have been new to it. We all were at this stage. He pushed the stick so far at my nostril that I'm surprised it didn't come out with a bit of brain on it. It was agony, but he insisted he was doing it right. He was wrong about that, but none of us would know it until someone else tested us. Even once I'd run that gauntlet, I was not in the clear. After waiting for test results and the minibus, we were taken to the freezing student centre for dinner, which turned out to be a tinfoil container holding a weird dish made of cabbage and potato with roast potatoes on the side. I don't think it was intended as a parody of Soviet-era cuisine. Why not have potatoes with potatoes? Potatoes are nice. I could have done with the third kind of potato instead of the cabbage. A group of cold and shell-shocked actors ate this lampoon meal under harsh strip lighting, unsure of where we'd be sleeping tonight, what the hell we'd got ourselves into, or if we were in fact being punked. One of us was still smarting with embarrassment over the fact he'd driven the wrong way over a one-way spike. I'm hardly a macho man, but I experienced the burning shame of making such an unmanly, unforced and basic error in driving. I was mortified, and the only good thing about it was I was playing a deeply unhappy, inadequate and angry man in the film. I don't know why I only get parts like this. So I could use this festering self-hatred for my performance. As much as I've tried to distance myself from the cliched notions of masculinity in my life, this whole incident was a perfect illustration of the almost unshakable insecurities that come with being a man. From the reluctance to ask for directions, through the inability to control my emotions, to struggling up that hill in the dark, and right up to the lingering sensation that I'd failed because of a minor driving error. All of this after choosing not to visit the GP despite having an exponentially expanding plum. I was a walking cliche. And with my car out of action, I'd now have to walk everywhere. I was so tired that I couldn't face travelling to a hotel and so decided I would take my chances staying in the fridge-like conditions of the student centre. I could wash myself with water from the kettle. I was shown to my room and had the choice of four tiny bunks that 1,000 school children had almost certainly wanked in. The extra blanket I'd procured did little to keep out the cold, and the seemingly solid rain pelted against the roof and walls, while the harsh wind did its best impression of the howling souls of the millions of Welsh people who'd perished in dreary conditions such as these after feasting on cabbage and potato and more potato. And there was no kettle. I lay there, sadly feeling my balls, unlike every other occupant of this bed, not for my own sexual gratification, or not only for my own sexual gratification, I'm only human. I'm wondering what was wrong with them. At least there was a chance that my problems would be solved, as tonight I was likely to freeze those bad boys right off. It's possibly the most miserable time I would endure in the whole of 2021, and without wishing to give too many spoilers, that's quite an admission. The next morning, after sleeping for maybe 60 disconnected minutes, I went down to look at the car in the cold light of day. It sat sad and alone in the muddy car park, its rear driver's side tyre sagging and empty. I didn't know it then, but this was a presage of the weeks ahead for me, where my own right-hand side rear wheel would end up in a similarly deflated state. A couple of days later, a Welsh man in a van came and replaced the tyre with a new one. This was less of a presage of what would happen to me, though I wouldn't have minded it. He was very efficient, and he made my car as good as new. His solution wasn't to simply hack off one of my car's wheels, but I guess that's why mechanics are more sophisticated than surgeons. On the ball. Always mind your bollocks. Bollocks has always been my favourite testicular euphemism. When it comes to describing bollocks, bollocks is the dog's bollocks. But where did the word originate? Bollocks, meaning testicles, is first recorded in the 13th century as ballocks. It derives from the Old English baelic. Now, no one knows how to pronounce that, but that's my guess. Meaning ball. An early source of it is Wycliffe's Bible, from way back in 1382, in which Leviticus 22:24 reads, "Albest that kit and taken away the ballocks is ye shall not offer to the Lord." And that's how I think people spoke in the Middle Ages. Or in more modern English, any beast that has been cut and the bollocks taken away, you shall not offer to the Lord. So kids, it's okay to say bollocks. It's in the Bible. In the late 19th century, bollocks had come to mean nonsense, And because priests and religious folk were, however unfairly, perceived to waffle on about a load of palpable old bullshit, bollocks quickly became a synonym for the clergy too. Weirdly, this association became a key argument during the obscenity trial directed against the Sex Pistols album Never Mind the Bollocks. Professor James Kinsley, head of English at the University of Nottingham, was called by the defence and argued that bollocks was not obscene because of its alternative definitions, clergyman or nonsense. The chairman of the hearing was forced to sum up. Much as my colleagues and I wholeheartedly deplore the vulgar exploitation of the worst instincts of human nature for the purchases of commercial profits by both you and your company, we must reluctantly find you not guilty of each of the four charges. Satisfyingly, in a study of UK swear words conducted by the BBC in 2000, bollocks was rated the eighth most severe word, right between prick in seventh place and arsehole in ninth. Exactly where it belonged. Chapter 4. Teenage Dirtbag. Even with the central heating fixed, the student centre was freezing. For the 5 nights I slept there, I pulled my thin blankets over my mutating body and spent sleepless hours nervously ball fondling. Was it just my imagination, or was my right bollock bigger than it was yesterday? What if it kept growing? I could become more bollock than man. The bollock might take over and turn me into its bollock to see how I liked it. I've always neglected the balls, not only in checking them for lumps and bumps, but even in the more fun times. Why hammer away at the oversensitive buttons when you have a joystick that can really take a bashing? Was this all revenge for taking my baby batter makers for granted? Finally, I had to pay some attention to my Jedwoods. I tried to push these concerns to the back of my mind and to concentrate on the job, but each night became more nightmarish. It wasn't only the appalling Welsh weather that was trying to permeate my four-bunked fortress of solitude. Like a demented Kate Bush, my rain-drenched bollock was banging at the windows in my brain, demanding my attention. When I got home, I once again turned to Google. This time, however, everything I read seemed very insistent that while it was probably nothing to worry about, I must immediately contact my GP. COVID was hitting its post-Christmas peak, and I was reluctant to clog up the system for those in real need. But I knew I couldn't keep putting this off. If the ball got much bigger, it might explode and take out half the houses in the street, and I wasn't convinced my home insurance would cover that. I presumed that I'd very much be at the back of the queue for appointments, so I was surprised and not a little concerned when they arranged to see me within 36 hours of my call. They were taking this seriously, too seriously, like this could only mean one thing. I had a day and a half to ruminate about the worst case scenario and wallow in the possibility that I might be checking out sooner than I had intended. I hugged my kids and told Catie that I wanted her to find love again once I was gone. It was play acting. I knew that the chances of it being something really serious were slim. It was like going on a scary fairground ride. It looks like it might kill you, and when you're on it, you experience the sensation of fear, but you know you're practically certain to walk away in one piece. That said, the knowledge that it's still possible that something could go horribly wrong gives the pretense a little tinge of genuine danger. In a perverse way, there's an element of fun to it. The ever-present threat of death is, of course, what makes so much of life exhilarating. How dull things would be if we were immortal. Once you reach your 50s, every visit to the doctor comes with the extra jeopardy that this might be the one where things get serious. It might still be years away, but it might be months away. Right now, it might be 36 hours away. Unless you're taken suddenly and unexpectedly, that moment where the doctor pauses, all stern-faced, about to deliver your own personal bombshell, is coming to us all. You just kick the can down the road and hope it's not coming too soon. I'd had scares in the past. About 15 years ago, a medical had thrown up the possibility there was something wrong with my heartbeat. The medical staff looked ashen-faced and told me that the heart monitor graph had a beat that went down when it should have gone up. They didn't need to tell me that this could be serious, as I was immediately sent to hospital for tests and to have my heart properly scanned. Everything was fine. That's just the way my heart beats, to its own rhythm. My body likes to do things differently, whether it's pumping blood in an unusual way, or failing to visualize thoughts, or trying to grow a testicle that might one day make it as a prize-winning pumpkin. A few years later, I had some test results that suggested I had a very mild thrombocytopenia and borderline splenomegaly. which would have been scary if it hadn't sounded like those conditions were made up by a four-year-old child. I went to hospital again, and they extracted samples from my bone marrow. They found a very small population of cells compatible with hairy cell leukemia. And surely the only way you can make leukemia not sound like awful news is to put the words hairy cell in front of it. While probably nothing to worry about, they wanted to keep an eye on me. I went in to see an oncologist annually for the next 4 or 5 years, but the blood tests always came back fine. And eventually, he agreed that the thrombocytopenia had corrected itself, probably because it was a made-up condition. After I told him I'd run a half marathon and set a personal best, he said I was clearly fit and there was no need for me to see him again. So I'd experienced that rug being pulled from underneath the feet sensation of thinking that my time might be nearly up, only to have the reassurance that it was a false alarm and life would go on. It's always a false alarm. Kick the can down the road. A big bollock isn't as scary as a heart defect or dubious cells in your marrow. While I had to consider my mortality again, it was from a position of near certainty that I'd be fine. I was able to indulge myself and almost enjoy the unfolding tragedy of an unlikely timeline where everything went wrong, like a sort of perverse schadenfreude where an unfortunate potential version of myself was the target of my glee. Look at stupid possible future Richard Herring crying over the fact he won't see his kids grow up and that in 5 years his wife will be married to someone else who'll be the only dad his son remembers and who will drink all that nice whiskey that dead old Richard Herring had been saving for a special occasion that never came. What an idiot. It's human to project in this way, to imagine the worst possible outcome and slightly enjoy this personalised horror movie. I think most of us believe that envisioning the most nightmarish eventuality somehow prevents it from ever coming true. Every time I've got on a plane, I've stated it's definitely going to crash, yet none of those planes have crashed, because fate hates to be predictable. No need to thank me, fellow passengers. I had your backs. I only feel sorry that nobody on all those planes that have crashed thought to take the same precaution. I'm also a comedian, and that meant an additional layer of mad thoughts. There was a part of me that was thrilled that something was wrong. In a way, wouldn't it be quite good if this turned out to be serious, or even terminal? Imagine the Edinburgh Fringe show I'd get out of that. It might have to be performed by a hologram of me, but if the show sold out, then who cares? This is the mindset of the professional comic. As long as something doesn't instantly kill you, every awful experience is material. I was already thinking of potential titles and ideas for jokes and imagining the awards I'd win for my challenging show about my suicidal testicle. I might even get a book out of it. It would be amazing. In idle moments, I've often thought of the jokes I might write if I lost a leg or was blinded. I've never been so committed to the material that I've decided it's worth purposefully maiming myself. I suppose it's a way to try and look on the bright side. I've been in the middle of terrible events, a fight, a humiliating sexual encounter, a mugging, a lot more humiliating sexual encounters, a plane seemingly on fire. I'd only imagined it crashing, not going up in flames, so fate got me on that one. And every time, a voice in my head has been saying to me, think of the jokes we'll get out of this. In a sense, it's part of what humour is about, finding the light side of tragedy, being able to laugh in the face of life's horrors. Even when we're powerless, it gives us the illusion of power. I admit, though, that it's deeply weird to be slightly wishing for something awful to happen to you for the lols. Come on, though. If there was something seriously wrong with my testicles, what a gift that would be. Balls are absolutely the funniest body part. In terms of generating laughter, there couldn't be a better organ to go wrong. You try writing a joke about liver cancer. It's possible, but you'd have to really work at it. Your balls trying to kill you, though? That show would write itself. It'd be just my luck if this whole thing turned out to be nothing. I might get a solitary routine out of a ball-based false alarm, but that would hardly be a consolation. Sure, if it was serious, I could die, but at least my kids would read my 5-star reviews and believe that their dead and half-forgotten dad had been a success. You can think a lot of crazy shit in 36 hours, and I was relieved to get to the time of the appointment so we could sort this all out one way or the other. I hadn't been to the village GP's practice since 2019, and things were starkly different to how they'd been on my last visit. First, there was a brand new young GP there who I'd be seeing for the first time. Secondly, COVID restrictions made the usually mundane and respectable task of visiting a doctor feel underground and illicit. The front door was locked. I buzzed the intercom and a voice told me I needed to wait by a side door and the doctor would let me in when he was ready. Shady. As I stood in the drizzle, someone arrived to pick up their prescription from reception. This time, the front door opened far enough for a rubber-gloved hand to emerge, holding a small wooden tray. The patient put their money on it, then the door shut. Shortly after, the tray reappeared with the drugs and the change, and the deal had gone down. It was as if I was in a terrible student sketch that imagined what it would be like if practicing medicine was illegal. However, as with so many situations in this weird year, it was soon going to turn into a poorly written sitcom. After maybe 10 minutes, the door opened and I saw the youthful face of the new doctor for the first time. I was smiling behind my mask, but he looked confused. "Who are you?" he asked. "Who was I? Had this man not watched TV in the 1990s? To be fair, my show was probably on after his bedtime, and most adults didn't watch it either, but that's hardly the point. "I'm Richard Herring," I said. "You can't be," he insisted. "I'm pretty sure I am." "I was expecting a 16-year-old, he said, and I was a little put out that he presumed I wasn't a teenager. Maybe one who'd lived a pretty high-octane life, but was it really beyond the realms of reality? We were not getting off to a great start. We stood awkwardly for a moment, seemingly having reached an impasse, but then he decided to let me in anyway, even though I wasn't me. In his room, he checked his computer. "Ah, yes, sorry, I had the wrong notes up." That was reassuring. "I've had four people in with the same issue as you this week." "It's an epidemic," I replied. "No one will even remember COVID when everyone's hobbling around with giant testicles." "Well, at least that can only affect 50% of the population." "No, everyone. That's why it's so scary." He laughed. He was a little scatty and nervous, but in very good spirits for a man coping with COVID, along with four men in one village having larger than expected testes. I told him that my ball had been feeling a bit big and hard for the last couple of weeks, and he asked me to take down my trousers and pants so he could examine me. As his gloved hand met my clammy ball sack, it struck me that this was the quickest I'd ever gone from meeting someone for the first time to them cupping my balls. There had been a girl at university who'd run him close, and she hadn't put a dampener on things by asking weird questions. That said, I think she was sick out of a window soon after. "Have you had any pain?" he asked. "Not at all." "Any blood in your urine or your semen?" "Not that I've noticed. I think I would have noticed." "Did your testicles descend properly when you were a kid?" "As far as I know. I mean, how far were they meant to go?" "Oh, just into your scrotum." "Oh, yeah, that's where they stopped. I was imagining them being like yo-yos." "Any history of cancer in your family?" "No." That was a bit of a concerning question. Was that what this was? The doctor told me not to worry and to get dressed. He agreed that the ball did seem rather hard and enlarged, but quickly reassured me. "The good news is, I don't think this is cancer." I let out an audible chuckle of relief and exhaled. I'd been more worried than I'd realised. "If I was a betting man," he continued, "I would say that this is epididymitis. Now, I know you're going to be Googling that when you get home. I was actually wondering which bookmakers would have taken such a weird bet and what odds they'd have given. The epididymis is the coiled tube at the back of the testicle. I knew this already. I didn't want to show off to the doctor, but I am the author of the seminal, pun intended, book about male genitalia, Talking Cock, available wherever you get your ebooks. And so I already knew the name and...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.